Ukiyo-e woodblock prints are traditional Japanese art form. They've depicted everything from beautiful women and kabuki actors to famous landscapes, motifs close to the heart of Japanese in centuries past. The first ukiyo-e prints appeared about 350 years ago. Then advances in woodblock printing technology made them more widely available. In Japan, ukiyo-e prints were a part of popular culture. But abroad, they became admired as fine art, giving inspiration to Vincent van Gogh and other famous Western artists. As Japan modernized, the ukiyo-e genre went into decline, but recently efforts have been made to revive it. Meanwhile, one Tokyo neighborhood is trying to renew interest in ukiyo-e prints and at the same time revitalize itself. On this edition of Begin Japanology, our theme is ukiyo-e prints. Through these works of popular yet fine art, we can glimpse the Japanese sense of beauty.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. I'm in the Asakusa neighborhood of Tokyo, which is an extremely popular destination for tourists, both Japanese and foreign. And this whole street here is lined with souvenir shops. Let's take a look here. A lot of them have motifs from ukiyo-e woodblock prints. For example, we've got some greeting cards here. You'll see Mount Fuji, that's drawn by Hokusai. Over here, some t-shirts, there's a kabuki actor there. Some playing cards, these lanterns here. These days, ukiyo-e are recognized as being fine art, but back in the Edo period when they were being painted, or printed, I should say, they were just cheap, mass-produced art for the general public. Let's start off today's show with a look at what ukiyo-e are.
Many ukiyo-e prints featured a bold composition and bright colors. Ukiyo-e literally means pictures of the floating world, which often portrayed scenes from ordinary life. Most of them were woodblock prints. These are bijinga, or beauty pictures, one of the major ukiyo-e themes. They were the equivalent of the photos of beautiful women you see in magazines today. One famous example is Hishikawa Moronobu's Beauty Looking Back. And this bijinga by Suzuki Harunobu shows a waitress named Osen. It was such a hit that male customers flocked to the tea shop where Osen worked to see her in person. Women were also interested in this bijinga. They studied Osen's fashionable dress and hairstyle. A bijinga was a pin-up photo, fashion magazine, and commercial all rolled into one. Ukiyo-e prints often depicted celebrities. Yakusha-e, for example, featured famous kabuki actors. This actor portrait is by Toshusai Sharaku. The close-up of the actor's upper body and exaggerated face make it very dynamic. These prints were the publicity stills of their day, and they sold in huge numbers. One example of an actor picture was the Shinie, which in some ways was like an obituary. Made and sold when an actor died, these prints included the age of the actor at his death, as well as his posthumous Buddhist name. Basically, they let the fans know of his passing. In the 17th century, many Japanese started traveling. That trend was reflected in fukeiga, which showed the landscapes of popular destinations. Not only did they allow the viewer to appreciate scenic vistas, they provided useful travel information. This is a picture of Shinagawa from an annotated edition of Utagawa Hiroshige's ukiyo-e series, The 53 Stations of the Tōkaidō. Here we see a courier and a palanquin, the equivalent of a postman and taxi today. There are captions pointing out the locations of inns, and also that the local delicacy of this area is seaweed. Other handy information includes the distance to the next post station. The Japanese of the time could actually use this print as a travel guide. How were these colorful and beautiful prints made? First, the artist sketched the way he wanted the final picture to look in Indian ink. The drawing was pasted onto a block of cherry wood to create a key block. The lines were then carefully carved by a specialized artisan. They could be as fine as 1/10 of a millimeter. Cherry wood has a very tight grain, allowing these extremely fine lines to be cut into it. Different colors were assigned to different woodblock surfaces, each one showing a different part of the picture. A single work might require as many as 6 or 7 woodblocks to be carved on both sides. This method enabled an efficient application of many different colors. Completing a set of blocks could take 1 month. In order to align all the blocks, registration marks were carved. When the paper was lined up with these marks, the different colors would line up as well. Then the printer applied the colors. He applied the pigment to the woodblock, then placed a sheet of traditional Japanese paper in line with the registration marks and rubbed it down. The print was produced color by color, with each successive print being checked. As the printer proceeded from block to block, more and more color appeared. One printing technique used was bokashi, color gradation. This was achieved by wetting part of the woodblock before adding the pigment and then spreading it gently with a brush. This pigment was transferred to the paper, where it created an effect of softly graduated color. Producing an ukiyo-e woodblock print required teamwork, the skillful collaboration of artist, carver, and printer.
I'm in the Isago no Sato Museum, which is in the city of Kawasaki, just south of Tokyo. And I'm going to be talking to the director of the museum, Mr. Fumio Saito. Thank you very much for being with us
today. How are you?
Now, first of all, how many ukiyo-e do you have here in this museum?
We have more than 4,000.
You keep it quite dark in here. Is there a particular reason for that?
Ukiyo-e prints are extremely sensitive to light. If you leave one in the light for 2 months, the colors will fade quite a bit. And that's why we are very careful to keep the lighting dim, basically as dim as possible.
There's landscape pictures and the actor pictures and the beautiful women pictures. Are there other kinds of ukiyo-e that are perhaps not quite so well known?
There are actually some that I'd like to show you in another room, shall we?
So, what have we got here?
First, we have this here, which is a very rare print. This was actually meant to be cut out and made into a fan. The instructions are written here.
These are the instructions, and so you cut along these lines and then it's folded up into a fan. Oh my God!
And these ones over here are a very different shape from the usual prints. They're hashirae, or post pictures. If the paper on your sliding door got torn, you'd get one of these and stick it over the tear. You could also put them up on the posts in your home as decoration.
Wow. For an average person who wanted to buy an ukiyo-e, how much money would they have to pay?
In today's money, 500 or 600 yen.
It's really quite amazing. The advent of ukiyo-e was a landmark in the history of Japanese visual art. Let's take a look at the history of that now.
Ukiyo-e came along in the mid-17th century. Here is a picture book from that era printed using woodblocks. The illustrations show people visiting a city pleasure quarter. Pictures like this depicting ordinary people and scenes from everyday life became known as ukiyo-e. The first prints were monochrome, printed only in Indian ink. In the late 17th century, these prints started to be hand-painted to make them more attractive. But it required a lot of labor to hand-color the prints one by one, making them expensive. This hampered the spread of ukiyo-e. The turning point for ukiyo-e came in the 18th century. That is when an artist named Suzuki Harunobu perfected a method of polychrome printing that produced vibrantly colored prints. This made possible mass production in color, which meant that basically anyone could now afford ukiyo-e prints. From the late 18th through the mid-19th centuries, famous artists like Hokusai and Hiroshige created timeless ukiyo-e masterpieces. In the late 19th century, Japan opened up to the West and entered the modern era. This is a superb print from that time, but overall a new fashion in Japan for Western culture caused ukiyo-e to decline. Yet at the same time, ukiyo-e prints entered the spotlight in a surprising place, the Paris Exhibition of 1867. The excellence of the polychrome printing amazed Europeans, who saw ukiyo-e prints as outstanding works of art. The Japanese prints influenced painters working in Europe. Perhaps the most captivated was the Dutch painter Vincent van Gogh. The vibrant colors, the strong lines, and the bold compositions of the prints fascinated van Gogh. He even painted copies of these two works, which come from Hiroshige's 100 Famous Views of Edo series. By reproducing Hiroshige's bold use of foreground and background composition, van Gogh set out to create a groundbreaking new painting style of his own. And the influence of ukiyo-e can still be found in Europe today. In this underground hangout in central Paris, there's a wall painting based on an ukiyo-e design. Here's an 8-meter-long mural of the famous Hokusai print commonly known as the Great Wave, done in acrylic paint. A young artist fascinated by ukiyo-e painted it 20 years ago. Since then, lots of other artists have maintained it. It's a kind of monument to ukiyo-e. In both East and West, lovers of art continue to be captivated by ukiyo-e prints to this day.
We have here in front of us an astonishing array of very, very well-known pictures by famous artists dating back to the 18th and 19th century. What was it that Western artists like Claude Monet and Vincent van Gogh found so fascinating about these ukiyo-e?
Elements of nature like rain, wind, snow, and mist, those were things they didn't think of as subjects for paintings. But ukiyo-e depicted those themes, and in a very fantastic way, too. That's what amazed the European painters of the time. This is Hiroshige's famous Sudden Shower at Atake. You can see there are thin and thick streaks of rain, and their angles vary slightly. The picture creates perspective using the rain. Or look at this. From the foreground to Mount Fuji, the smaller wave here makes up one layer. Then this big cresting wave just about to break forms the second layer. This boat is the third layer. And nestled in the back is Mount Fuji, the fourth layer. In short, the picture has these overlapping layers, which give it a sense of depth. Ukiyo-e artists had a sensibility that has carried over into the modern era.
Wow, thank you very much. Unfortunately, the traditions of ukiyo-e have gradually been disappearing, but recently, and very fortuitously, a set of woodblocks of Hiroshige were discovered, and these have inspired an effort to make sure that Hiroshige's ukiyo-e are now passed on to future generations.
As we've seen, ukiyo-e prints are made with multiple overlaid colors using woodblocks, In January 2009, a set of seven woodblocks used for printing in the mid-19th century were found in an old house in Tokyo. Woodblocks would wear down and ultimately be thrown out. They were considered disposable, so few have survived to the present day. The owner of these woodblocks is Yuji Omori. He happened to find the blocks while sorting through the belongings of a deceased relative. What got his attention was two kanji characters carved on the block.
At first, I thought about throwing them out, but when I looked closely, I saw the name Hiroshige. So I thought I should take them to an expert and have them examined and make a print from the blocks.
Omori took them to a research facility specializing in woodblocks, where they were judged to be authentic Hiroshiges. Omori and the artisans decided to restore the woodblocks for future generations.
The blocks have rotted quite a bit. We'll just have to try them to see how damaged they really are.
The man who got the ball rolling was Noboru Nakata, a woodblock printing artisan with 50 years of experience. First, he spreads Indian ink all over one of the woodblocks. The wood has been ravaged by worms and old age. Nakata uses experience and intuition to rub with just the right amount of force. When the paper is lifted, the crisp outline of a Japanese beauty appears. This was originally drawn by Hiroshige around 160 years ago. The artisans were especially surprised by the woman's hairline. In the most detailed spots, three hairs fit within the space of 1 millimeter. The hairs were carved individually into the woodblock. It's extremely difficult for anyone today to recreate the precise technique by which this was done.
The skill is just exceptional. In the past, there were people who specialized in carving just the heads. The art was on a higher level back then.
When printing the colors, an unexpected problem crops up. The colors are applied and printed from the blocks one at a time, but
no, it doesn't match. It shrunk by a millimeter.
The blue of the woman's kimono is slightly offset. Although the printing blocks are made of tough cherry wood, they were stored in poor condition, so they have warped. Several colors have to be printed on the same sheet of paper, and if even one color is offset, the whole print is ruined. To minimize the offset, Nakata spends a long time making minute adjustments to the registration mark. It's 2 months since the project began. Omori is invited to the workshop. All the adjustments have been made, and a final version of the print is being prepared. Over the span of about an hour, 12 different colors have been laid down, and the final image emerges.
I didn't imagine it would turn out so well. I can't remember the last time I felt so excited.
A design by Hiroshige, printed by modern-day artisans. It's a lively picture of a woman taking an evening stroll by Tokyo's Sumida River. In fact, a version of the same print is currently in the collection of a Japanese museum. It's the one on the right. As you can see, the new print's colors, which were made following directions on the woodblocks, are more muted. A fresh discovery was also made. On the sash of the kimono can be seen an intricate pattern. Up to now, based on the older print, it had been assumed that the sash was unadorned. But in fact, the pattern had faded. If you look carefully at the woman's face, you can see that the new print also reveals there was intended to be a light touch of red makeup around the eyes. Yuji Omori wanted to show the world a true example of Hiroshige's work, and he succeeded. This new print reveals a great deal about how the art of ukiyo-e amazed the world.
If you're an ukiyo-e enthusiast, the scenery behind me may seem just a little bit familiar. Hiroshige did a series of prints called 100 Famous Views of Edo, and this is one of them. It's entitled Inside Kamedo Tenjin Shrine. Of course, the period when Hiroshige was active was the mid-19th century. It's a long time ago, and most of that scenery is now long gone. This bridge is actually a rare exception. Ukiyo-e are something that you don't really see a lot of in your daily life in Tokyo these days, unless you go out to an art museum or something. But one neighborhood in Tokyo is trying to bring them back into our lives, both to renew interest in ukiyo-e and also to boost local business.
Nihonbashi was the nexus of old Tokyo, drawing in people from across Japan. Lots of old shops remain in business here, but for younger Japanese, Nihonbashi is not a very appealing neighborhood. To draw more visitors, shopkeepers here started a project to paint the shutters and walls of local stores with ukiyo-e murals. This ukiyo-e picture shows a famous scene from the popular kabuki play, The Subscription List. This shop is a caterer that's been in business for 160 years.
Originally, our shutter had nothing written on it at all. It felt empty. Now the impression our shop makes is quite different. I hope it will become a local landmark.
The project began in 2007 as a way to commemorate the 150th anniversary of Hiroshige's death. Hiroshige spent his last years in Nihonbashi, and it seemed fitting to decorate the neighborhood with famous images by him and other famous ukiyo-e artists. This is a hardware store. Its shutter has a scene from Hiroshige's 53 stations of the Tokaido. And this soba noodle shop has a mural based on a print in the Hokusai series titled 36 Views of Mount Fuji. When the shops are closed, the neighborhood streets feel almost like an open-air museum. In the 6 years since the project began, 25 murals have been completed. Since 2009, the project has received funding from the city of Tokyo and from the local authorities. The initiative is led by Haruki Kawasaki, the organizer of a group that leads walking tours around Nihonbashi. He is the one who came up with the idea of having ukiyo-e images painted on shutters.
80% of the ukiyo-e prints were made available by publishers here in Nihonbashi. The art's roots are here, yet no trace of those roots remained. It seemed a shame. The prints themselves are small, but I thought it would be fun to decorate our shutters with enlarged versions.
Right now, the 26th shutter mural is being painted. The painters are Eiki Mizutani and Yuka Murao. They are both Art University students studying Japanese painting. They're continuing work that older students from their university were doing up until last year.
When you're painting on paper, you can repaint again and again. You can use the brush to undo mistakes. But with this, you have to get it right at the first try. It took some time to get the hang of it.
The painting of the shutter can only be done while the shop is closed. So it takes about 2 months to paint an ukiyo-e mural this size.
We don't do ukiyo-e printmaking at university. As we replicate these images with paint, we're learning a lot about the composition and the power of these pictures from the old days.
The ukiyo-e shutter murals have impressed visitors to Nihonbashi, and Kawasaki is now receiving requests for new murals from many other shops.
Since only the older buildings have shutters, I'm thinking about having ukiyo-e images painted on big canvas cloths. Then they can be hung up at the shop entrances during the day, and they can be in different colors that show the shop's age at a glance. For example, 100 years a dark blue, 200 years green, 300 years brown. Then you'll be able to tell the age straight away.
Ukiyo-e images springing up in the streets of Nihonbashi. Kawasaki hopes that within 3 years there will be 100 of them. His plan to use ukiyo-e designs to publicize the fascinating old businesses in Nihonbashi is just getting started.
Here's another ukiyo-e. This one's getting a little bit of attention at the moment. It's the work of Utagawa Kuniyoshi, who again was active in the mid-19th century. And this one seems to be predicting the future. Why? Take a look at this tall structure here towards the left, and then look over there. Look pretty similar, don't they? Now, that is Tokyo Skytree, which was completed in 2012, about 150 years after this print was done. So, what's this? People have speculated that maybe it's a derrick for drilling a well, or perhaps a wooden tower like you sometimes see outside small stadiums. Nobody really knows for sure. Anyway, anything that brings attention to ukiyo-e can't be a bad thing, I think. Personally, I really like those murals that we saw in Nihonbashi as well. I don't know who it was that decreed that shutters have to be painted grey, but anything that brings a little colour to our lives is certainly fine with me. I'll see you again next time.